And welcome to another edition of the Bucks County Central Bucks Senior Taskforce meeting. I'm Jim McGowan, I'm your host for the day, and we broadcast these interviews once a month. On the first Monday of every month, we meet here at the Central Bucks Senior Center at 700 Shady Retreat Road, and we have various guests every month. So please consider joining us some Monday. You can watch these from the comfort of your own home, but you can also come and be a guest at one of our interviews. Today, we're going to be talking with John Vogel. John wears multiple hats. One of the most prominent hats that he wears is as a volunteer with CARIE, which is the Center for Advocacy for the Rights and Interests of the Elderly. They're located in Philadelphia. However, they take care of the whole state of Pennsylvania, and we're really fortunate that they're close enough that they can send someone like John to speak to us today. So I may only have a few questions to ask John because he's so full of information that I think you're going to just get your pencil and paper out and get ready to write things down. So, John, welcome.
Oh, thank you very much, Jim. It's an absolute pleasure for me to come out and spend some time with you and all of the seniors to be able to deliver some kind of message to you that isn't so scary that you think, oh, my gosh, everything's wrong. It's not. What we're going to talk about a little bit is Medicare, and we're going to talk about a little bit of Medicare fraud and how fraud happens and how that statement that we all kind of put into our head, it'll never happen to me. But it really does, Jim. It does happen to us. Mm-hmm. And it does affect each of us every time that it happens. So I'd like to start with just a little bit of information on the fact that Medicare does provide some information. I'm just going to show this to you. This is your Medicare and You book for 2017. Everyone should have received one of these already, Jim.
It does have
some information in there about Medicare fraud. It does give referral numbers. It does speak a little bit about CARIE so that there is some contact information. When people say, I have no idea how to contact you, how do I get a hold of you, you can go to your Medicare and You book for 2017. So that is a good reference for us to be able to have and use for a start place for people to get information both on their Medicare and on Medicare fraud. One of the, and I'm going to hold up my Medicare card. My Medicare card is a lot larger than yours because yours is paper in red, white, and blue, and either in your wallet or in your purse. I made mine bigger just so I can read it. But if you're carrying one of these cards, if you have a Medicare card, you are in a system that has the opportunity, sadly enough, to have fraud occur to you. When I talk about fraud, we are the SMP. The Senior Medicare Patrol. We are a nationwide, as you said, organization. We take care of fraud, we take care of abuse, we take care of scams. We work very closely with all kinds of seniors on kind of figuring out is it just a simple error that happened on their bill, or is it a pattern that something's actually happening with people so that they know the concept that there is fraud going on. There is a technicality of finding out if it was just a simple error that happened to your bill. Somebody piped into a computer really simple and it ended up being, well, that's a mistake, very easily corrected. Or are we dealing with a situation that is grown? And I will give you the worst case scenario that we had in 2016 was a $1 billion fraud case. So when we talk about, oh my gosh, it can never happen to me, I don't even have to look at my bills, I trust my doctors, I trust the hospital, everybody treats me like gold, I would never think that anyone's doing any kind of fraud against me. Well, here's
I would think, yes.
$1 billion does happen. So the Senior Medicare Patrol started way back in 1997. It is a nationwide program that happens. And I don't mean to shock anybody. I don't mean to scare anybody. I'm just going to give you some facts and figures. $68.8 billion and we have to add that billion now, the addition.
Okay.
$69.8 billion occurred in Medicare fraud. That was lost money to the Medicare system. Yes, we go out after everybody we possibly can. And that's the real problem, Jim, with Medicare fraud. It doesn't start with us being investigators. It starts with, say, consumer actually looking at something and saying to themselves, that doesn't look right. Something's wrong on my bill. The problem is we get so many of these bills and we don't understand. If you're in a Medicare Advantage plan, then you are getting an EOB, an explanation of your benefits. What did you have done? How much did it cost? What did they pay? What do I have to pay? Does it seem reasonable? Is there something on there that looks really odd? If you're in Medicare supplemental insurance, then you're getting an MSN, a Medicare summary notice. Both of them, from a standpoint of a consumer, we aren't taught how to read that.
Right.
We aren't going out and somebody's not saying, well, now, John, this is what this means and this is what this means. Nobody does that. We get these after we have experienced some type of medical help, of whether it's blood work or a test or a doctor's visit or a specialist visit or into the hospital or the emergency room. And then we get this document that is so confusing to read that we look at it and we go, I'm not sure what that means. Well, it looks good to me. I guess that's okay, you know, because nobody's going to, you know, they aren't doing something terrible to me. It should be correct. Mm-hmm. Well, it all starts with that. When you have a Medicare card and you're enrolled in a Medicare Advantage plan or your Medicare, you're enrolled in a supplemental plan, you do receive these documents when you go, Jim, and have some kind of medical treatment for you. You do get this document, and it is something that just doesn't get thrown into the pile. You really should be looking at it, whether it be a simple, I went to my family doctor, it's my regular checkup, and I get this statement, it looks, and oh, I don't think I had that done. I'm not sure that I had that test done. Call the doctor. They pick up the phone and call your family doctor and say, did I have that done in the office? Because I don't remember having that done. Mm-hmm. And of course, in most cases, especially today, in today's market, billing isn't done at the doctor's office. Billing has been outsourced to someplace else. And the person you're talking to at the family doctor office is going to say, I have another 800 number for you to call. Call this number because they do all our billing for us. And you never know where you're calling. If you're lucky enough to have someone, a doctor's office, have their billing done locally, you might recognize the number, a 215 or 610 number. You might recognize the digits. But most of the time, it's going to be an 800 number.
Mm-hmm.
And the one thing that people, seniors, really, really hate, that confuses them to no end, is it's another 800 number. Especially since we have 800, 866, and all. We're calling, and we have no idea. And most of us, when we call that number, we're saying, okay, and the first thing out of their mind, their mouth, is to say to you, well, do you have your bill in front of you? No. Can you go get your bill? I'll wait a minute. They don't even know if they have a bill because they didn't get a bill from the doctor's office. They just have their MSN or their EOB, and they don't understand anything that's on there. So the first thing that they look and go, I'm not calling. I'm done. I'm just not going to call. So we wonder, how in the world can $69 billion in fraud happen in Medicare? How does that occur? Where does it all start? It starts with you and me. People who carry a Medicare card who fail to look and say, that just doesn't look right to me. So somewhere along the line, we have to, and I don't like to use the word train because it's not a nice word for us, but somehow we have to make people much more aware of what is going on so that we can do. One of the things that we are looking at and have been looking at, and one of the places that we always start, is back on your Medicare card. And I will refer to my Medicare card quite often because there's a number on your Medicare card that is quite important. For all of us right now, our Medicare ID number is our Social Security number. That is what we use. The system is going to change, and I'll explain that in a minute or two, but
we all know that on our Medicare card, well, we're supposed to know that that is our Social Security number. Well, what were we all taught, Jim? Take our Social Security card out of your wallet, hide it in your sock drawer, don't let anyone ever see it, because that's how bad things can happen. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you over all these years that I've done this, how many people I've said to them, do you know your Medicare ID number? No. It's your Social Security number. Oh. So you go to the doctor's, Jim. You go and you sit down, and the first thing they ask you is, has there any change in your medical coverage? Can I see your Medicare card? And you get your Medicare card out, and you lay it out for anyone to see. It's laying out completely in the open. Now, one of the things that's happened in yours and my life that we didn't have before was something called a cell phone. We never had those. When we were growing up, all we did was yell out the window, Jim, you want to play baseball? You know? Now, today, everyone has a cell phone. Well, the guy who's sitting, standing, or right behind you, and you can feel his breath in your neck, and you're going, back up a little, back up, you know, because they're just a little too close. Well, he has that cell phone, and maybe you think he's talking to somebody, but he's holding the phone out like this. Takes a picture of your Medicare card. He instantly has your Social Security number, and boom.
John, does everyone have that card? Or is that just for people with original Medicare? If you have a Medicare Advantage program, does it look like that?
The difference within Medicare is when you come into the Medicare system, there's two ways to come into the Medicare system. Age, meaning 65, or through a disability, you can come into the Medicare system. Then yes, the answer to your question is everyone would have a Medicare card. Everyone gets them. They can have both Part A and Part B, or some people would only have the Part A if they have some other way to pay for their Part B of Medicare, and I'll explain that in a minute. But somewhere along the line, yes, the answer to your question is it doesn't matter if you're in the Medicare system. When you come in, you receive one of these cards. In most cases, Jim, in most cases, if you go into a Medicare Advantage plan, the person who's selling that plan to you will tell you, you no longer have to have your Medicare card with you. You can take your Medicare card out, hide it in your sock drawer with your Social Security card.
Okay, so that still is...
But it's still, they don't lose. And I can't tell you how many people over the years have said, well, I don't have Medicare anymore, I lost it. No, you don't lose Medicare when you have a Medicare Advantage plan. It's suspended. But on the other side of the coin there, to answer your question, is I can't tell you how many people carry their Medicare Advantage card for whatever provider it is, and right behind it, there's their Medicare card. Right behind it.
I see.
That's
okay.
Where it is.
I'll check my wallet.
The idea is the fact that this card, your Medicare card, contains some very, very important information on it, and not only the fact is your name correct or not, but it has your ID on it. And if someone takes that ID, they have taken your Social Security number, and it just leads to an incredible amount of problems for you. In January 1st, 2018, for anyone new coming into Medicare, anybody just coming into the system, they will no longer use their Medicare number as their ID. So anyone new on January the 1st, 2018, the system will change in hopes, Jim, in real hopes that that part of Medicare fraud, of ID theft, will no longer exist because we have taken the Social Security number off of their Medicare card. For all of us that are already in the system, right now they are projecting that on January 1st, 2019, we would all receive a new Medicare card with our Social Security number removed from that card. I believe that system will correct some of the idea of Medicare fraud. But you and I would be total fools to not believe that the bad guys are going to figure that system out really quick, and we'll go back to having to do exactly what we're doing now. Make sure that you know what's going on. So Medicare fraud basically starts with this. Never, ever, ever. give your Medicare number or lay your card out where somebody, especially a stranger, can see it. I'll give you a very simple example of this. I was in an emergency room with my wife one evening. We were sitting, she was getting some treatment done, and I'm sitting there and I'm watching the gentleman, and all of us who have ever been in the hospital know that these people walk around with a little cart with the computer on to check you in and everything else. And there was an emergency in the emergency room. And the person who was checking that, the other people in the next room to us in, took their Medicare card and put it on their cart. And because of what I do through Medicare fraud, my automatic clock went on. 4.5 minutes that card laid on that cart for anyone to see. Now, when the emergency was over, he came back and immediately got the card and gave it back. But for 4 minutes plus, anyone would have had the opportunity to have taken the personal information from that consumer and done anything they wanted with it. I can tell you the consumer himself had no clue that that even happened to him. Mm-hmm. So there are multiple ways. It's not like we're walking around and waving this, hi, take my numbers. We're not doing that. It is the very subtle ways that Medicare fraud starts and it happens.
Where is most of the fraud contained? It was like we had been talking earlier about the $1 billion, and that was these nursing homes, 14,000 beds, and these people were manipulating the system and got that. Is that basically how it gets up to $70 billion? And what can, if I'm not going to be in the nursing home, or what about John Doe down the street there going into a local hospital? What kind of fraud happens on a daily basis, let's say right here in our backyard?
Say it enough, Jim. Say it enough. The number one culprit in Medicare fraud is physicians, doctors.
Okay.
There is more fraud, and I'm certainly not saying at this point in time that every doctor is a fraud and every doctor is ripping people off. There are many, many, many times where, especially what has happened to the complexities of trying to be a doctor in today's world, where it might not be the physician himself, but someone within his employ, someone within the ability to see documents that shouldn't really be there. When you and I were growing up, pretty much the doctor's wife was the nurse. Mm-hmm. Pretty much the doctor's wife was not only the nurse, she was the billing clerk.
I was growing up, yes.
She was also the person who wrote down everything the doctor did, and it went into the file, and she was not only that, all those other jobs, she also filed everything. Today, everything is out there, so you could have a very simple case within a medical practice. And since physicians, more Medicare fraud happens in physicians' practices than anywhere else.
Okay.
Ambulances.
So it adds up then. $1,000 here, $1,000 there. Is that how we get up to that? You don't always get those billion-dollar cases.
No. I would like to be able to say to you that's the largest oddity that mm-hmm. would ever happen.
Right.
But we do get lots and lots of cases, which are $30 million, $40 million, $50 million, and you wonder, how did it ever get this large?
Yeah.
How did it? And it really does happen from the simple case that if someone doesn't look, if someone isn't paying attention, and we'll use you and I as an example, if somebody, I get a bill and I look at it, and something doesn't look right, and I think to myself, it doesn't look right, it must be right, and I put it down. And 2 days later, you and I are having coffee, and I say, you know, I got this bill, and it just didn't look right. And amazing enough, you say, I got the same thing. And then we talk to Mary and Susie. And next thing you know, there's a whole bunch of people who are not realizing that they are all within the same framework of fraud. That's where it builds up. Yes, it takes an enormous amount of investigative work, the attorney generals. Everyone works with this, local detectives, everybody works in these cases where we get into $50 and $60 and $70 million in this. But it really is the fact that we have, and I know of cases already on a small doctor's office where the one of the employees who was a longtime employee enjoyed doing some other extracurricular activity, and funds were disappeared. Mm-hmm. The doctor had nothing to do with it. Didn't even realize, because they trusted their employee completely. But the call to Atlantic City was just a little too strong. And the next thing you know, $50,000 was missing, or $60,000 was missing. Well, when we're talking that kind of money, we are talking about John Vogel. We are talking about, I'm a Medicare carrying card person. I go to the doctor, and the next thing, I'm not checking my bills, but somebody's taking my money. How does Medicare fraud affect you and I, though? I mean, that's the question that we really get down to. How do we get to the point that $50,000 or $1 billion affects you and I? We've all known over the last few years, benefits that are no longer getting paid for, especially on the women's side, things that they no longer have the ability to get paid for. We also know that there is an enormous amount of people that are paying more for the same benefit. And it doesn't matter if you're in a supplemental plan or if you're in an advantage plan. All of a sudden, that benefit is higher. Out-of-pocket money for people. We've risen to the point now where it's $6,700 in almost all of the Medicare Advantage plans. When we started this, we didn't even have out-of-pocket money. And that was only 2007. Now, here we are, 10 years later, and you and I, if we enroll in a Medicare Advantage plan, are agreeing to $6,700 in out-of-pocket money. We're going to pay that money. How did that come about? Medicare fraud. Medicare fraud has as much effect on how the benefits that you and I are receiving and how much we're paying for those benefits beyond anything else. Well, there was a long time where people blamed it on, well, people were getting rich, these people, oh, it's research and development, all this. But it has as much to do with the fact that you can't take $69 billion out of a system. And it is billion. I am using the word billion. $69 billion out of a system and not affect you and I, the users, the people who are the users. We go to the doctor because we have an illness, we need to have it taken care of, we need to be able to do it. Medicare, never, ever, ever, and I am asked this question all the time. People will call me and actually say, John, I just hung up, it was somebody from Medicare, they called me. Pardon me? Medicare never, ever, ever calls anyone. Medicare doesn't text you, okay? Medicare doesn't email you. You do not get contacted by any other way except good old snail mail. We're trying to keep the post office in business, okay? Snail mail, that's how you get contacted by Medicare. So if you have someone who calls and says, oh, hey, Jim, I can get you a brand new Medicare card because I know they all get dog-eared to go through the wash, you know, I'll get you a brand new Medicare.
Social Security number, and I'll send it in mail to you.
I got it. All you got to do, no, and they don't even ask you for that. They'll say, we already have your information, and because we all know that our Social Security number is 324, it's a sing-song. So I can kind of guess it's 1-8-2-4-3-7-8-5-6. No, that's not my number. My number is gotcha. So Medicare, the part that people really need to know. And you know what? This has nothing to do with being astute, being college trained, or all of us can get caught up in the moment of a phone call, especially when somebody says, oh, I hear your cat's in the back. Oh, is that the dog barking? Mm-hmm. Boy, I can almost smell dinner. Now I'm your friend.
Yeah.
I'm your friend. And Medicare fraud happens in the split second that you say, that's not my number. My number is... And boom.
How many people would you say, what's a percentage of people that might experience Medicare fraud even though they don't know it?
That is about as a loaded question as I've ever had.
Okay.
I'll answer it two ways. All of us.
Okay.
And when we're looking at $69 billion, all of us, okay?
Okay.
Somewhere along the line, we become so accustomed to saying, oh, thank goodness I have it, it's paid for, I don't have to worry about it, never realizing that something occurred. It would be really hard to quantify a percentage on that happens.
And I ask that because I do know, even though I may say I've never had experienced Medicare fraud, I do know that it seems that the person that I know that runs, that's the treasurer for the Little League, has stolen money from. I mean, I can't recall how many times I've read in local newspapers those type of incidences where, like, a clerk at a doctor's office or a dentist's office, like, you know, they absconded with $50,000, $100,000. And these are all people that we don't know them personally, but you know one of them personally. Mm-hmm. I know one of them personally. I had a friend who was an attorney, and I saw that, you know, all of a sudden the money disappeared from clients that person was taking care of. And it just shocked me. But at the same time, I realized that, okay, this is how ubiquitous fraud is in our society. And when you get something like Medicare, when there's not the, I suppose, is it the oversight? There's not enough oversight, you know, and that's what causes it. Mm-hmm. Or there's not enough people from the ground up being aware of those statements.
Well, I guess one of the perfect examples of what you're using, the scooter store. We all became very used to the scooter store. They had television just clamored with the store. And you saw the little gentleman who drove over right to the edge of the Grand Canyon, which, by the way, you can't even get that close. But television is a tricky business. So problem was, and I can give you the number, $87.7 million was overbilled to Medicare from the scooter store. Yours and my concept is if we walked up and down our block, we could almost guarantee you a certain percentage of people in each of our blocks has a scooter in their garage. You know, it was Aunt Millie's, and Aunt Millie's gone now, but we don't know how to get rid of it. We tried to give it to somebody, but nobody wants it. And Medicare paid for that, and Aunt Millie, really, to tell you the truth, she never needed a scooter store. She didn't need a scooter. So it happens all the time. Tenet Healthcare, a huge company out of New Jersey, $900 million in fines by Medicare. So there is part of the collection that heads back.
Was that an institution, or is that a...
Tenet Healthcare was a provider.
Okay.
That was a provider. Yeah. Medicare summary notices, I have one with me. It's very, really, very difficult to get through and understand and figure out the numbers. Who pays for what? How much gets paid for? How come they have all these zeros on here? Does that mean I don't pay, but how come I pay this? That's where you get into. But you can't be afraid of a Medicare summary notice. You can't be.
You
can't be afraid of this. You have to look at this and say, how could this cost so much money, and how come nothing got paid on it? That's where we get into the concept of Medicare errors. Medicare, you know, not everybody. I often use this cute little story that I think of. You know, Mary got hired by this company because Mary was really quick on the computer. She could really type like a crazy person, and she could get everything in there. Problem was, Mary's now up to 23 errors. And her boss said, you make one more error, Mary, and you're going to be unemployed. And sure enough, that afternoon, Mary's a nervous wreck because she can see him standing right behind, and Mary makes an error. Do we really think that Mary's going to raise her hand and say, come here, boss, come here, I made my 24th error, it's not going to happen. So the error goes out, and Mary's not going to call you and say, oh, gee, I made a mistake on your bill. You need to find that and say that's not correct and do something about it. It is always one of those Medicare summaries, EOBs, that you have to look for. It's very simple to understand. There's three things that you look for. Really not rocket science, three things. Charges for something that you didn't get done. That's what you want to look for. Look on this bill and say, I never had that done. Now, there's nothing wrong with calling the doctor and saying, I never had that done, and them going, yes, you did, here's when we did it. We're not supposed to be, you know, remembering every detail of everything. Secondly, billing for the same thing twice. If you see on your bill that
a particular issue was done, a particular procedure,
and it went into the computer, and my finger was a little heavy that day. It went into the computer five times.
You might have had the test done three times in a month, but if you had it done five times on the same day within 5 minutes of each other, that's an error. That's an error. Look for things on these bills that have been billed twice. Services that were not ordered.
Question.
Yes.
Does CARIE go out and go to groups like this, the Central Bucks Senior Center, and bring with them, you know, that 5 or 6 or 7 page Medicare summary and say, okay, folks, you know, I'm going to send these out to you. Everyone's going to have the same bill, and we're going to go through it one at a time to really get them educated to what each line is.
I do that, Jim, when I do the presentations to senior centers. Mm-hmm. I always use mine simply and solely because it's real.
Mm-hmm.
I don't create one. I use mine, and I do make copies. I pass it out to the audience and say, find me the error. And it just so happens on this particular one that I'm doing, there was an error.
Uh-huh.
And when you make an error with the Medicare trained specialist,
you're going to get caught.
You're going to get caught.
Well, we might have to have you back here then, for that.
Yeah. So please look at all that is going on with the concept of your own medical expenses. There are many places that expenses are created that you should take a minute to look at. It's not always at the doctor's office. I think one of the most confusing places is the ER. I think when you go into an emergency room, you're normally there for something that's got you a little bit shook up and everything else. And most of us don't understand the concept of an advocate. Most of us understand the concept of a friend. Go along with me. Go along with me. You know, I don't want to go by myself. You know, my wife went with the girls to, you know, something. And boy, look at this thing. We, you know, take me over to the emergency room. I need an advocate. The understanding of what the difference is between you as my friend and an advocate. An advocate is someone who is going to be able to actually stand up and speak for you when you either are saying things that are incorrect or can answer. Sadly enough, I've been, you know, with many people who were unconscious and could not even answer, and what did they want? And well, we're going to repeat that blood test. Well, we're going to repeat the blood test again, you know. And you're in the ER and you're in there for 17 hours and five times you've had blood drawn. Remember, each time they did that, you're paying. But you're not, even if you are conscious and aware of things that are going on, because of what is happening to you, most of the time we have IVs in us, most of the time we're in, have that stupid thing on that, you know, they haven't invented yet to be a better piece of clothing.
And you're not in your right mind.
And you're not thinking straight. You're not. Yeah. So you, whatever gets ordered, you just continue to go on. You need an advocate. You need to be able to say, Jim, if something's going on and it seems like I don't understand, would you speak up for me? Would you be my advocate? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who that is. Technically speaking, you know, when we get into the legalese of this, we can have POAs, power of attorney, people who do it for their health, who do it for their finances. But many times they're not even available. You know, it does end up being someone who knows you a little bit, a neighbor who's going to go to the ER for you and say, wait a minute. You know, I'm not sure that Jim wants that done. I'm not sure that John has to have that done. There is a big difference, and one of the things that can truthfully affect Medicare fraud is to have a good advocate when you're in a circumstance that you can answer a question as clearly as you wanted to do. Because it's going to be, remember, it's 6 weeks till we get our bill.
Right.
It's 6 weeks. So we were in the ER for 17 hours. We were moved to that wonderful thing called transitional care, which is really confusing within itself because we really weren't admitted into the hospital. We're just in this transition time to see if we need to be admitted to the hospital. and there's all kinds of billing problems that go on there and stuff that goes on because they move John up to a hospital room, and you're on your cell phone calling my honey and saying, yes, they moved him into the hospital. It looks like they're going to admit him.
Mm-hmm.
And she comes dashing over and says, thank you, thank you, thank you. And you go home, and I'm in a room, and it looks like I've been admitted because I'm getting meals and tests and everything else. And by law, you're allowed to be in transitional care for 7 days. At the end of 7 days, they have to make a decision on you. But in most cases, in about 3 days, they decide that, well, we're going to make a decision on John at this point in time, but he's not well enough to go home. So we're going to send him to the infamous rehab. That's where we're going to go. So
nursing rehab,
here again, we keep referring to us, and we're not old guys. Mm-hmm. We're young guys, yes. You know. But in our lives, rehab was done at a rehabilitation hospital. Today, rehab is done anywhere. So I get moved to the rehab. Well, Medicare has federal law says you must be admitted into the hospital, into the facility, for 3 consecutive midnights in order to get the next level of care paid for. Well, I was in there for 3 days, but I thought I was admitted into the hospital. That's where Jim left me.
Okay.
Jim left me in the hospital room. He said, here, John, here's your honey's here. Go home. I'm going home. Thank you, Jim. Thank you. And I thought I was in the hospital because that's what I thought I heard you say in the cell phone. It looks like they're going to admit him, but they didn't. 3 days later, the doctor says, you're not well enough to go home, so go to rehab. Rehab is not getting paid. Medicare rules. Must be admitted for 3 consecutive midnights, not 3 consecutive days. 3 consecutive midnights. Now I go to the rehab. 6 weeks later, I get a bill for $10,000. I'm feeling better. I can walk now, you know. And I'm looking at the bills and I'm going, that can't be right. I thought I was admitted to the hospital. The bill's $40,000. Now Medicare makes all their adjustments to that and everything else. But there's no way under the Medicare fraud system that I have a checks and balances, a way to figure out, was this done? Was it correct? Did I actually get this? Because I was in transitional care, and now I'm in a rehab. So you really have to be very conscious of the fact that it's important beyond to pick an advocate. It's so important.
You had mentioned earlier about when it comes to getting involved with Medicare, when you come of age, so to speak, that you need training, okay? That there should be some type of training required to get that Medicare card so that you can, you know, when you do get that a statement in the mail, you know what's going on. Or if when you do go into a hospital, that there's something to educate you as to what you can expect. But, okay. We're going to wrap things up now.
Okay.
Okay. I'd like everyone watching this video to know where they can get in touch with, maybe not you, okay, but at least with CARIE, and if they have further questions in regards to you know, Medicare and fraud and what they can expect, because I'm sure someone who's watching has, like you said, they have that bill in their hands and they just don't quite know what to do with it.
Mm-hmm. If for any reason. And you know what? This is always proven out to me completely. If in your gut you kind of have that, ooh, that just doesn't feel right, it doesn't look right, CARIE is the organization you want to go to. And you can call CARIE. It's an 800 number. Sorry. But you can call the 215-545-5728 or 1-800-356-3606. You can always call. Those are the numbers directly into CARIE. CARIE, located down in Philadelphia, you can always call them Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. If you have a question, you can call your local apprise counselor. Federally, we are the SHIP program, the Senior Health Insurance Program, sometimes called the State Health Insurance Program. In Pennsylvania, it's called the apprise program. You can always call the apprise program, and we will assist you to get you directed to figure out if you need to go to CARIE or if it was an error. That's 1-800-783-7067. Apprise, every county in the state has an apprise office. Some are in the Area Agency on Aging, some are independent. You can always call the apprise people. They are all trained to make sure what is going on with your Medicare, and they might not be trained in the Medicare fraud side, but they can very well give you some directions on, especially things like the scenario we just talked about, because apprise can help you tremendously.
Yeah, the apprise group is through the AAA here in Bucks County, the Area Agency on Aging. Okay. Well, John, I want to thank you for coming from Philadelphia. You came from Berks County?
I came from Reading this morning.
From Reading.
I came from Reading this morning.
Okay, well, there it goes. See, there's a man dedicated to his job here. not to his job, to his volunteer positions.
Correct.
So, John, thanks again for being here with us today. And we invite all of you to come next month, on the first Monday of the month, for our next edition broadcast of the Central Bucks Senior Task Force. Thanks for joining us today. Salam. So